No, I'm quite.
Gentlemen, welcome to our today's session of Manobhav Express Yourself, conducted by Break Glass Sealy Private Limited. In short, we can say BGCL. BGCL aims to augment professional excellence of women. We will prepare women for boardroom positions, be in capacity of independent director, non-executive director, or at CXO level. We also prepare women who are interested to move fast and further in their career in leadership roles, be it any vertical or any industry. Our today's topic is the woman leader in me an entrepreneur too? Yes, we have Miss Shilpa, Miss Dr. Sunita Chugh, who is an entrepreneur, a founder of Center for Empowerment and Employability Education. She is also a consultant, trainer, coach, and academic writer. I just request Dr. Sunita Chugh to start the discussion.
Yes, without wasting too much time, when you have five such important people and you have guests like Poonam Sangha sitting there in the audience, or Samira Sachdev, and so many others, Ritu Kaul, I feel that this is such a wonderful occasion, and 90 minutes is too little a time to really get a handle on such a big subject. But where I'd like to get started is we have five luminaries, great panelists, and I want to hear, like audience, I want to hear from each one of you as much as possible and not really talk too much. So what I'm going to do is invite Padma to share first a little bit about how she just dived into becoming a farmer after being in such a bureaucratic power center like the government and working with something like pension for underprivileged, you know, and writing so many amazing publications with, you know, Dr. C. Rangarajan. So, you know, when you have that kind of a personality on the panel, I would like to hear straight away from the horse's mouth, what makes an entrepreneur?
Thank you very much, Sunita, for letting me speak first. I see a lot of faces that have been part of this journey, and one of the primary faces I see is Sanjay Kauls, Sanjay Bhai as I call him. I guess sometimes when you want to be an entrepreneur, people see it even before you can see it. So I think about 12, 15 years back, I was not thinking of the journey. I was one of the first people to point out about my passion for plants, and he kept at it and kept sending me article after article on kheti. And I kept wondering what's wrong with this person. So the first lesson I learned essentially was that there has to be something which is inside you. There is something inside you, and it's just that when the right rains come, things simply sprout. I was just talking to Sunita, and I think my first understanding of what I had and I couldn't see was with Dr. Rangarajan, like I was telling Sunita. That's when I understood that I could write. I had never written an article before that in 15 years of my service. And I started writing. He said, you can do it. And I suddenly found myself being able to do it. And that's when you start realizing that life leads you in a certain direction. And the pension scheme that you are talking about was my first exposure to the rural areas. So when we were doing these pension schemes for the underprivileged, we were going to people like the Amul Dairy milk farmers. So suddenly I was talking in Gujarati to a bunch of milkmen and telling them why they must buy a financial product like pension. Something so sophisticated. And that's when I suddenly realized that if you're able to create the right environment and a right fit, nobody needs any training for anything which is like beautiful, something fundamental. It's similar experience we had with the Seva women. I mean, all of us know, we all wear the Seva Lucknow Kurta. So this is an organization in Ahmedabad. Everybody knows Ila Bhatt, Dr. Ila Bhatt. And these are women who earn 200 rupees a day, 150 rupees a day. And they understood the importance of why I must save for my future. So that was one experience which suddenly kind of told me that there was something I wanted to do post my retirement. So that's how the whole thing started. And then, of course, there were enough people to nudge me, like, you're nudging me now. So there were enough people to nudge me. And so I deep dive. And if you ask me what is the moment, it's very difficult to say when it was. Was it 15 years back or was it 1 year back when I actually resigned? Very difficult to say.
So, so wonderful. Padma, and we are going to keep coming back to each of you as panelists. So what I'll urge the panelists to do is give small snack bite to the audience, because snacks are more enjoyable and they will get to know you as you are talking. And it's so wonderful to hear you, Padma, because what you're saying is sometimes people see strengths in you which you yourself miss. You're also talking about mentors like Dr. C. Rangarajan, who saw the writing capacity in you. So sometimes people give you feedback. And the third thing that I heard you talking about is people know. Even a person who earns 200 rupees knows that he or she is supposed to save that. And so your financial product was actually meeting the market need. And there's a click sound, you know. So you can, with all your academic brilliance, and all of us can think of products in the market, but the audience or the market already is ripened enough to meet you. Yeah. So you've put the spotlight on three or four important aspects of entrepreneurship, and we'll keep coming back to you, Padma. So we'll keep coming back to each one of you. So hold it. Give very small snack bites so that the audience is assimilating these points. Yeah, we want everyone to be educated through this, because BGCL is actually doing this work to make sure that if anybody in this audience wants to become an entrepreneur, immediately after this session, they would be able to reach out to all five of you or any of you. Manju is going to put up the contact details at the end and you can take it on from there. With a brand like Shilpa Sharma, I cannot stop. Jaipur. Jaipur.com. A lot of women burnt a lot of holes in their husband's pocket as well as their own when they went out to Jaipur.com. And Shilpa was the woman behind Jaipur.com. Tell us a little bit about your story, Shilpa, of how you moved from ramping up Fab India to from a two-digit store number to a three-digit store number, and leaving Fab India to start Jaipur.com. Was it on a rebound or what? Tell us more. We are curious.
Thank you, Sunita, and thank you to BGCL for having me here and giving me an opportunity to share my story. So, you know, there's really no linear progression in my career path. I started my career in advertising, moved very quickly from advertising to sales and marketing, and spent about 6 years in sales and marketing between Cadbury and Marico. I think for me, changing lanes as I was acquiring some life skills, you know, and experiences, because I wasn't quite happy doing what I was doing. You know, it just felt like rigid pecking orders. The, you know, there's a hierarchy in large organizations, large corporations, which kind of didn't go down well with me, because the underlying understanding was that you've got to end up towing your boss's line because the boss is always right. I think Fab India as an opportunity, you know, landed itself in my lap. You know, it was looking to open a store in Bombay, and, you know, I was in Bombay. By then, Fab India had only about 4 stores around the country. And I joined them in 1998 to help them open, you know, their first store in Bombay. But I think that was like, you know, a milestone moment for me, because in the next 12 years that I spent in my journey with Fab India, you know, there was tremendous amount of learning, but there was tremendous amount of opportunity really to take things on, to take charge. It became fairly evident to me that there was no rigid pecking orders. You know, I wasn't answerable and accountable to my boss, who was William Bissell. I wasn't answerable on a daily basis. There was a mandate to open stores, and, you know, I just went right ahead and did that. So, you know, when you get authority and that responsibility, then you want to be able to take it on and run with it, because you're almost scared of letting them down. I mean, I kept telling myself, oh my God, you know, there's that much faith in me. So I have to work twice as hard to ensure that, you know, I never, ever let anybody down. So the sense of accountability and responsibility that came with that freedom, with that empowerment, really, to go out and open stores, allowed me to really, you know, be the person I, you know, I could be, I wanted to be, And I don't really understand empowerment as a language then. You know, it took me some time to figure this is what empowerment means, right? Being left to your devices to be able to do things that you need to do and just to, you know, keep forging ahead. So, you know, I think for me, to be able to get from being a store manager to being able to open over 90 stores over a period of, you know, 10 years, 90 stores, you know, contracts for the 32 stores that would open over a period of time around the country, really woke me up to the opportunity and to opportunities. I mean, I was surprising myself. You know, you look at yourself and say, really, did I just do that? I mean, did I just sit across the table and negotiate to buy a property worth 3.5 crores? You know, it wasn't something that I'd been trained to do, but I think it's just that passion for what you're doing. It's that willingness to take that leap of faith and somewhere having that faith in yourself, right? Being very self-assured and confident that you were going to be able to pull this off. That really egged me on. So yeah, I mean, you know, I left Fab India because I think at some point in time, there came a time when, you know, my dreams and aspirations for Fab India became much bigger than the shoe I was wearing, right? I mean, the organization had raised, you know, private equity money, and therefore they were committed to increasing the geographical footprint to about 250, 300 stores. But look, for me, my learning had stopped. I was not going to add too much value to myself because I'd reached a stage where I could open stores with my eyes shut, pretty much. I had an opportunity to move to Delhi to take charge of buying and merchandising, which I did. But there came a time when I thought, you know, my dreams and aspirations became much, much larger. And it became fairly evident to me that, you know, what was good enough for the organization was not good enough for me. And that's when, you know, I decided to kind of, you know, take charge of my life, because, you know, I feel that if there is a status quo, something's going to have to shift. Either I'm able to shift the perspective of the board, or then I have to shift the way I'm looking at it. And it became fairly evident to me that, you know, I should move. And, you know, I moved on. And actually, Jaipur didn't happen for a good 3 years. So there was no question of rebound, you know. When I quit Fab India in 2010, I started my own little consulting practice to help other businesses in fashion and lifestyle, you know, expand or become operationally efficient. I set up a travel company and I was very happy consulting and running this travel piece. And then I think just serendipity somewhere that, you know, I got introduced to somebody Puneet was this young techie who'd been a product manager and had worked only with e-commerce companies over the last, you know, 9-10 years. And he said, you know, I mean, I know the future of this country is online. I just don't know what to sell. And I had those ideas, those dreams that I had for Fab India, you know, in terms of the approach to product, in terms of, you know, being able to really give a contemporary twist to traditional craft to so that, you know, it gets reinvented and continues to be relevant, not just to an Indian audience, but a global audience. And that's what we ended up doing with Jaipur.com. So yeah, I mean, it was an opportunity. Somebody had to grab that opportunity and do something with it. And
great. We'll hear more about your travel company in a while. Shilpa, thank you for that introduction. We'll hear a little bit more about your travel company in a while. What I want to put the spotlight on is four things. Shilpa is talking about being an intrapreneur first. So almost for 12 years at Fab India, she was an entrepreneur, not an entrepreneur. And she played with big projects with 3 crores, etc. You know, those examples she gave. The second point she's saying is, I wasn't trained for it. I wasn't trained to open stores. But yet at a certain point, my learning had stopped. So learning is embedded in my journey. I want to learn, you know. So entrepreneurs have this kind of a streak that they are constantly learning. And also she ended her talk with opportunity, you know, seeking opportunity. It is not like you stop at status quo and you say it's all right. No, not giving up is a great quality that she talked about. And the last point that I noted down was that there was nothing like in entrepreneurship that you can start it when you want. So there was no rebound from Fab India. It was more like it took 3 years to find that big opportunity called Jaipur.com. So, you know, it's not something that you can just do. you learn and you're on the go and you're picking up opportunities as they're coming to you. So Shilpa, thank you for that. And I'm going to move very quickly to a very, very important person. Sanjay, you'll bear with me. You are the last on the list because, yes, you know the reason. Yes. And I'm going to go to Ankita before I come to Anubha. Ankita, how does it feel when you see all these gray-haired people sitting on this call, like they are diving into new projects? And how does it feel for someone as young as you, who's just merely graduated last year from Pearl Academy, right?
Yeah.
And just dived into and bootstrapped an organization. I mean, where did that confidence come? And what is it that you would like to share with the audience about your story?
I want to start by saying that I'm really, really humbled to be here. I've actually assisted on one of shoots for Jaipur. I was the assistant to the stylist, through the assistant stylist. And it's so humbling to just even be here and hear Shilpa ma'am speak, you know, about her journey and her transition. And so many points that she said are so relatable, because when I think about it, I was just in college. I was like 19 when I decided I want to fully pursue like a brand of my own. I want to do something that, you know, vocalizes my creative language to the world. And I got into fashion really, really young. I've always known that fashion is something that I want to be a part of. It's glamour and history and art and culture and so much blended into one thing for me. So when I sit here and I hear all these people talk about their journey and how much struggle they, you know, had and the transitions that they made, I feel I'm so young to even, you know, say something like that. But I've always known that I wanted to be an entrepreneur. It's not something that I had any doubts about, very honestly. I come from a business background. I've grown up watching my dad, you know, lead a great business. And I think that instinct of just making the right decision at the right time was kind of embedded. But it was a huge leap that I took. I have completely bootstrapped my business from day one. There hasn't been any money that I've, you know, taken from here or there. And more than any of, more than finances, I believe that the support system that I had with me in terms of my parents and my friends and my mentors who have taught me fashion and design, it was so self-assuring that I didn't have the chance to doubt myself. So I'm glad that I took that leap of faith. Very, very happy with where I stand today, and I'm so excited for the future, and I'm just really happy that I'm on my entrepreneurial journey that I've always dreamed of having.
And your business is about? Tell the audience.
A year and a half old, just a year and a half old. We based out of New Delhi, and I have two strands to my designing currently. I work on very raw hand-painted denims. And then on the other side, I work on very delicate couture collections. So I'm kind of just sort of catering to the kind of sides that, you know, I have as a young person. You know, how I have different sides to myself. And just trying to relate that with my audience and give them something that they can resonate with. And I'm just literally learning as I go. Even here, I'm hearing so many people talk and I'm making notes and I'm just learning so much. And it's a journey. It's tough. It's difficult, especially when I'm outside and I'm dealing with a completely different side of production of fashion, which people don't get to see. You know, people usually see the runways and the shoots and the glamorous side. But there's a very different side, you know, when it comes to production and dealing with carigers and tailors and all these artisans. And they always look at me, this young girl, and they don't take me seriously enough. But as we go, as we work together, as we move into the process, I kind of, you know, develop a bond with them. And then they kind of see the potential and give me a certain leverage, you know. So it's been quite difficult as someone so young, but I'm really excited about the future because I feel I'm learning so much at an early age that I will be able to implement all the more into my business as I grow.
Wonderful, Ankita. And I think all the three speakers so far have put the spotlight on what you were saying just now. So cutely you said it, you know, that people have faith in me. And yeah. I think the most beautiful part about leadership is that when you walk tall and when you walk on a journey that matters to you, you do find people actually instilling that faith. Padma talked about it. Shilpa talked about it. You know, she said empowerment. And people just don't empower people who are not capable. And I think when you take a decision and you decide to take charge of what you want to do, you will suddenly notice in the humility that you said, or in the gratitude that you spoke, that everybody around was actually having faith in me. And that's so beautiful. We think that should come first before we take charge, but it's really a very tricky piece, you know. Does leadership happen first, or does entrepreneurship happen first? You know?
Right. So it's kind of like a mixture of both, honestly. You know, when people start showing their assurance in you, you kind of, you know, go beyond your capabilities to prove them right, you know, to always uplift that confidence.
Yeah, and you're saying it so nicely, Ankita. Best wishes to you. And of course, we're going to keep coming back to you again. Small bite again from you, Anubha. Anubha is a colleague. I mean, we are part of the same fraternity. I do training and development, and Anubha belongs to the same sort of community which does training and development for the country. She's written a book on research. Anubha is a speaker. She works across boundaries of the nation. She's done amazing work. And what I want to hear from you, was it a matter of choice that you started a business, or was it something that was always there on your the radar that you should not be an employee? Because you've worked with very good companies like Honeywell and Moody's, and you have learned quality from these companies. So how important is quality? Something that I want to hear from you. And also, your profile speaks volumes about how you bring in the hard skills and the soft skills of Six Sigma and, you know, quality training along with the soft behavioral aspects. So you're far more potent than what you your resume sounds. That is obvious. So I want to hear, or at least I want the audience to know definitely from you, was it something like leaving these big companies where you worked in, was it a matter of a choice, chance, or something that you've been imagining for long or dreaming, something like that? I don't know. Yeah. Take it the way you like. Yes.
In fact, I was, before I start, let me first really thank...
A little louder, Anubha.
Is it okay? I'm fine. Audible?
Yeah, Manju, is Anubha audible? Okay, yeah.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's audible.
Yes. Go ahead, Anubha.
Okay. So, as I was mentioning, So firstly, I would like to thank you, especially the BGCL team, and obviously making me introduce. Well, I'll talk about quality in some time, but I will take up the Shilpa ma'am's thought process, first of all, that somebody actually observe you, you know, and which you yourself don't know. So I would like to quote one instance here. After 20 years, I was just having a chit chat with my college friends. So I'm from Lady Shram College. And, you know, they just told me one thing. Kehte, Anubha, we knew that what you are today, we were very much sure about it. So I was very surprised. Because what is it that you knew about me? You know, he says, one is that you were a very go-getter. You were a passionate girl and a drive for achievement, which I was not even aware of it, you know. So sometimes other people know more about you. So the word which I use, one is passion, one is drive for the result orientation and happy-go-lucky. So the quality actually comes from here only, trust me. So it's like we talk about voice of customer. So first is our internal voice. We should know what exactly we want. It's like owning your own power, your creativity, your own determination. That really makes more of your life. And if you can give it back to the corporate or into the society and can transform, you know, so workplace transformation, what we call it in quality. If you can give it, trust me, the quality has actually started breathing. So now about my entrepreneurship. Honestly, I never decided. I never knew that I wanted to become an entrepreneur. I was would love to become a homemaker with, you know, handling my husband, my daughter, and, you know, chilling out. But then I realized that, yes, there is someone in your life who actually come and trigger you, you know. So for me, the trigger is, you can't do this. When someone says this to me, it clicks me. It says, let me prove it. So for me, the mantra of life is, if no one thinks you can, then you have to. It's very simple. So whether, if I give it in a very simple manner, the way Shilpa ma'am just shared it right now, there were some instance, great things about in Fab India, but then how she, you know, transformed and came across and gave the Jaipur as a product to the worldwide. the lead was there itself. You know, if no one thinks you can, then you have to. And she did it. The same is with me, you know. So the trigger has to take it in a very positive manner. So there are challenges in life, whether you take it in a soft skills manner, hard skills manner, or let's say in a quality term, you just have to improvise it. Because, you know, there is nothing called perfection. Every time you keep changing, every time you keep enhancing and enhancing and enhancing. So there is no level of perfection actually. So the newcomers is actually coming up with a new way of looking at things. And this is what is there. But yes, working with a blue chip organization like ICICI Bank, you know, Moody's, Honeywell, actually made me realize that yes, there is something can be done to the people orientation side. Because one thing which I was not knowing about me, but I'm a very people oriented person, and then I realized that yes, what I imbibed from my father, he being an IAS officer, and he was a gold medalist in his IAS in two subjects, physics and maths. Now the way he used to teach people with a very simplistic example, you know, that made me engraved in myself that if we can transform person by with a basic and simple example, that means you have done your job. I think that thing is in me, and that's how the journey of learning and development came in, because I was into this particular role and I took it up with a quality blend, and that's how I'm here. So this is how I have the story of mine.
Thank you. Thank you, Anubha, for answering that question so beautifully, because you are putting the spotlight on when you have the determination. You talked about how your friends saw that can-do spirit in you. You talked about what Padma and Shilpa talked about, you know, that people sometimes see it in you before you see it in yourself. And sometimes you just want to do something and you don't know where it's coming from. But sometimes you get the triggers from outside saying, no, you can't do it. And yes, that too can be a motivator. You know, in Buddhism, they say the desire to do something and the fear of something, both can be motivating, you know. So the encouragement can come either from some pull, somebody is doing all positive things. So sometimes we think everything happens because of a positive container. But sometimes the fear of something also drives you to get to that motivation level. So last but not the least, I want our panelist Sanjay Kaul, who set up BGCL, to first of all say a few lines about why he set this up. I mean, you know, when I first heard about it, I said, oh my God, I had worked with Sanjay when he started UPES and made it such a big brand in Dehradun. I said, why does it take a man to set up a break glass ceiling private limited? Why can't women do this? Why can't women get women director to become women directors? But then I stopped and I said, no, it takes a man with a certain kind of vision, A, and a man with a certain kind of ability. It's called androgyny. In Hindi, the closest word I have is Ardhanarishwar. You know, where you're able to blend your femininity and masculinity with equal ease. You know, it takes a certain capacity to be able to see something masculine and feminine at the same go. So to become a woman director, you don't need just feminine qualities. You need a lot of result orientation, task orientation, which I think Sanjay ke andar kut kut ke bhara hua hai. I've loved working with him, with his passion and enthusiasm. So I'm going to invite him to share BGCL story as well as UPS story. And does business or entrepreneurship, and especially the way Anubha and Ankita have not put the spotlight yet on that, though Padma and Shilpa did put it, does business to become a brand have to be scaled? You know, does it have to be of a certain size? I clearly want to hear that, because some of us feel so small. We say, no, we are not entrepreneurs because we are too small. So I want to hear answers to that. So once again, BGCL story, the UPES story, as well as scale matters, size matters in entrepreneurship. Sanjay, over to you.
Thank you, Sunita. First of all, I must compliment you to get such a cosmic bouquet together of women leaders. Somebody who graduated in 2019, somebody who graduated in 1989, somebody who's a serial entrepreneur, somebody like you, you know, who's such a able leader's handler, I would say. And of course, people like Anubha, who are bringing all kind of humanism in all of this, what we do on a day-to-day basis, which we call commercial and achievement and winning. So excellent. I think if we have panels like this, if we have participants like this, then whatever BGCL wants to do wouldn't be too difficult. As it has been in my journey, I have no mission for BGCL as such. It is actually breaking the glass ceiling. I think there is an artificial ceiling out there where when everything else fails, you bring the gender as a cause. I think this is the biggest scam on this planet going around for 2 million years, that we have defined roles, we create an ecosystem where we hardwire genders into certain roles, and we are perpetuating this scam generation after generation, civilization after civilization, and we are not man enough or woman enough to call this scam a scam. It is a scam. Telling a woman that this is what her capabilities are even before she has become a person. Telling a man this is what is you're supposed to do just because you're a man is a scam when you compare how well we are educated and informed. So having said that, the journey which one has had is only with one mission. I have seen that the best people to empower women are women themselves. And if BGCL can facilitate women getting empowered, whether through information, whether through counseling, whether through support, whether through networking, whether through finding job opportunities, entrepreneur opportunities, funding opportunities, anything which they can help out with each other to get ahead, to fulfill their aspirations. That's what BGCL is. Because that's what men do. They reach out, they have a network. If women have a empowered network, they will empower other women. So there is a very simple formula for BGCL that empower women. And if that, any way that happens, the organizational support is there to be able to do it. Now coming to the journey, I don't think that our achievements were too great. They were simply aspirations. Everybody chases dreams. So did I. But what was a stark reality in them is that it took me 10 years to change 0.02% participation of women students in hardcore engineering subjects. 10 years it took. It took us almost 12 years to reach the participation of women faculty in hardcore subjects from 3% to 14%. In my consulting days, I have set up two practices for two big fours in India. It took me years and years to bring women in hardcore, so-called, as we call it, suited professions like M&A and and such hardcore consulting areas. So why is it such a struggle? I mean, I can't find any reason that why need women have to be heroes and volunteers to be doing jobs and occupations, which are very normal for anyone to do. So one would like within this lifetime to correct that. So that's where one is at. That, okay, one has seen this reality. How can one help? And we believe that when you empower anyone, you empower one person, one family, maybe one region or one geography. When you empower a woman, you actually empower a civilization. Because, traditionally, whatever woman leaders I've heard, whatever civilizations you have seen, it is now a proven statistical fact that it is the women who are the bar of the civilization. Wherever they are treated right, wherever equal opportunities are provided, that institution, that geography, that state, that country is always better. So maybe it's a little noble, but the practical thing is, can we do something for the audience which are there on the seminar? Can we be a network ourselves? Can we help one person? Can one person within this group, can, for example, Ankita from tomorrow make it a mission that every employee she takes, every vendor she gets, she's going to see whether she's empowering a woman. I mean, it's as simple as that.
Right.
Coming to scaling, I think scale is a matter of business. And no scale is big enough or no scale is small enough. I think it is, one has to start somewhere. And my recommendation always is that prepare yourself not only for business, but also the business of business. The business of business somehow is far more becoming important, whether it is technology, structuring, compliances, the way you deal with people, the way you seek professional help, the way you set it up. A lot of people have ideas, but I think scaling is part of that. Scaling is business of business. So there is this business which gets you started, but immediately prepare yourself for the business of business. And if you don't have those skills, get into partnerships, get into alliances. There are companies and agencies and people who only market. There are companies, agencies and people who manufacture. There are companies and people and consultants who only design. It is not a bad idea to have 500% business and 500% the business of business always into that. And I bet in this entire process, in case you are going to give the woman leaders the chance, there is this opportunity which one is missing for thousands of years, hundreds of years, and certainly in the last three decades, because now they are ready. They are willing, they are ready, they understand it. They don't have any technological or any barriers. There are support systems which are solid. So in case in the business of business, you make alliances where you're consciously choosing women leaders, not that that is not on merit. I'm saying just a little bit of consciousness, just a small example. If you have a position, do not decide about that position till you have a woman candidate also competing. I'm not saying select her, but go, if you need a vendor, see whether you can get one. I mean, these are the kind of initiatives, and you may not succeed in 100% of the cases, but those 30%, those 70% of cases you are succeeding, your returns are going to be far more greater, I can assure you, because wherever we have tried in the last 20 years, this has proven us more than right, will be greater. There will be definitely a better product, better scale, better compliances, better market penetration, better CRM, everything better. I don't know whether Sunita, I answered your question, but these are some of my thoughts.
Absolutely. And one of the things along with scale that you mentioned was this whole aspect of it taking 10 to 12 years. Now, people like Ankita and many others who are listening in, this is not to get demotivated, but to have a reality check of how entrepreneurs' stamina, you know, the stamina and the appetite that you need to have has to be something across time. It has to be across failures. It has to be across, you know, for 3 years, Shilpa was not waiting for a knock on her door. Or for 10, 12 years, Sanjay was not waiting for number of women engineers to become a certain number. And I've invited Manju to unmute, get everybody's mics unmuted, because we've had one round of familiarization of the panelists. And I'm going to invite or make the floor open to questions, because I've attended many webinars and I find the moderator talking a lot or the panelists just talking in a direction in which it makes sense to them. But here we have a very beautiful audience, and I'm going to invite the first question from, can I just ask somebody, Bindu, do you want to ask a question? Or would somebody like to type a question? And in the time being, I'm going to just summarize what Sanjay said. I think scale is something which is a matter of business. And that was beautiful. I love the way he talked, the passion with which he talked about BGCL. You know, it is something that if we could just sponsor women, just become a wee bit more conscious about sponsoring women. He talked about how don't complete the final interview till you have at least one candidate sitting who's a woman on that panel, on that list of shortlisted candidates. So it just takes that extra effort, just that little bit. I'm going to go and get this noise shut off. Manju, I'm requesting you to unmute the mics and look at the first question that comes into the chat. Can we have some volunteers here who will ask a question? Because we want to make this for you, not for us.
All mics are unmuted. One can ask the questions, please.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I am Rohini.
Yes,
and
Rohini, go ahead.
Hi everyone, this is Rohini. I really want to ask everyone on the panel that do you have any steps to go about in the beginning, like when you think about jumping into the entrepreneurship pool or whatever you want to call it? Do you have any steps which you can guide for someone like me or anyone? Wherein, you know, do this A, B, C, D, and then see how it goes or something like that.
Okay. Can I take that?
Okay. Please.
Yeah, Anubha, please go ahead.
Okay. So, Rohini, thank you for asking this, because this question is really, I think, relevant for all the people who are actually planning to become an entrepreneur. Firstly, I'll put it in a very simplistic manner for you, right? I'll say 4C, okay? The first C is carve. You need to carve the journey. When I say carving the journey, which means you need to set your goals. What is it that you really want? You know, in a corporate world, we call it vision, okay? But if you'll ask personally, I'll say, just be sure what you really want. There would be probably 100 things you want to do. Just write it down, you know? And then start carving out what you're looking at. Just penning it down. Second thing is connect. The second C. Okay. Now get connected to your best. You know, so what Sanjay Kaul sir was mentioning, that we need to create an alliance. Now that's basically a form of, you know, connect. Connect with your family members, connect with your friends, connect with your corporates, family, you know, colleagues. Connect with the, you know, get a great alliances, or, you know, have a, get into the association board. So get into the connect mode. The third one is crazy. I mean, I would say just be crazy and be passionate, whatever you think and decide. So it's like you have to go a hit and trial, right? You, I don't say that you will immediately achieve. So the journey of entrepreneurship, what I've seen is the first year when you start, you will, you know, get a great result and you will see, wow, you'll say, oh, things are working out. Second year, that result will go a little bit dip. Third year, you'll go again up, but dip. Fourth and fifth year, there will be a stagnancy, or probably you might go down. Now that is the time you will be exploring so many things and you will get to know that what you are really good at. That fifth year, either you will go back and be a part of corporate or be a part of your home or whatever you want to do. But if you take that leap, trust me, you will go really, really high. And in this, the fourth C is being creative. You need to be creative every time, whatever you do, you know. So if I tell you my journey, I started with my trainings. I started with the corporate trainings. Obviously, soft skills, behavioral and quality was three, because they were my blood. They were in my blood because of my experience into the L&D domain and quality domain. But then I always had a passion that something to give it back to the society so that everybody start following it. So I got my own philosophy. That is what we worked into the scalable model, which we called it as a PRISM philosophy. And then the third, I got my college, which is in Solon, and there are 300 students studying, and they're going to pass out in the, you know, next year. And it is, you see, I first carved, I got connected with the people,
I was crazy for what I wanted to do. And finally, I was creative in all the things. So this is in a very simple 4 C's, I can put it across. This, I mean, I don't say you have to put it in a structured manner, but hit and trial. That's the input I can say, Rohini.
Thank you for that takeaway, Anubha. That was a beautiful takeaway, the 4C model, and maybe you can spell it out again at the end. Rohini, did you find an answer in that?
Yes, of course. But my point here being that I have seen, and in my, I don't have that big of an experience or something in terms of entrepreneurship or anything. But point is that where the point of connection comes, you know, I have seen and experienced the lack of passion in people of helping others. I have seen that, you know. So that is something which is not one panel or one group of people can do, you know. But yes, it is. It can be started there. But
here we have a panel whom you can contact. I would say very confidently. Someone like Padma, someone like Shilpa, someone like Dr. Poonam Sangha here, Sanjay, Anubha, Ankita, they would be able to even spend half an hour with you on the phone, telling you very clearly what that next step should be. And Anubha too, you know, and Anubha has already given. So yeah. That enabling and helping is something that the more precise your question will be, the more you'll feel helped.
Yeah, I understand. Do reach out. That is why I simply ask for the steps. That is the most precise I could get.
Good, great. Coming back to this discussion and the panelists, they've taken out this precious 90 minutes for us. We don't want to lose this opportunity to ask. Padma, I'm going to come back to you and Shilpa. And I don't know which one of you is going to take this question first. You know, do you have thoughts or regrets? Like, I wish I had done it when I was much younger, because you're doing such amazing work today, both of you. For example, the brand Organic that you are have started out, Padma, and the brand Breakaway and Mustard that Shilpa, you're working on. Do you feel sometimes that one should start young or wait till you get a certain years of experience? Because I know in this audience, we have people who might be just waiting. Both of you, actually. Yeah, please go ahead.
So, Shilpa, can I take that first?
Sure, please do. Please do.
Okay. Frankly, there is no right time. Really, like I said, it's when your cup is full and that urge really overwhelms you, is probably the time you should do it. So, I guess age is probably just one of those things which maybe you'll have more energy, more physical energy when you're younger. But when you take it on at my age, probably you've done a lot of interpersonal skills you acquired, which is a different kind of a strength you acquire. So really there is no right time. And Rohini, there are actually no right steps. I mean, feel free to connect to any of us. And so a puzzle can be put together two ways, right? It's a 1,000-piece puzzle. I can just randomly start intuitively doing it, or I can start arranging and doing it. Neither of the two things are wrong as long as you've got the puzzle back in place. So I'll hand it over to Shilpa now, or anybody else who wants to take that on.
So I would totally second what Padma said. There is really no right time to do things. You follow your heart, you follow your passions. Just make sure that you get very good at whatever it is that you're passionate about, because passion on its own can actually be quite overrated. You know, I mean, we're passionate about one thing today, we got something else day after tomorrow. And if you're not good at it, then, you know, it's kind of hard to stay interested or hard to monetize it. So find a way to become really, really good at whatever it is that you are passionate about. Enough to make a business out of it, enough to, you know, be able to monetize it so that you can continue being, you know, there. The other thing that I want to say is, you know, I've had the opportunity, and I'm really, really fortunate that I had the opportunity to actually dabble with and make, well, not just dabble with, but also build brands in three of the most wonderful, the most interesting sectors, which is lifestyle, fashion, travel and food. I think for me, it was just an extension. It was just an outcome of a love for travel, a love for good food, a love for all things beautiful that allowed me to really look at what it is that we could stand for. So for me, the primary motivator is really what is it that I can do that no one else has ever done before. So, you know, if there is something that you know you can stand for, something that you feel can be unique to you, then by all means, see what you can do with it. I mean, you know, when I got into travel way back in 2011, actually much before Jeppo.com, I didn't want to be yet another travel company, right? I mean, to go into the travel space and to be another travel agent or tour operator was, it would be a bit like, you know, going into an already full elevator, right? And then trying to jostle for elbow room. I was quite clear that I didn't want to stand for mainstream tourism. I only wanted to be about what we call beyond the brochure experiences of India. And from where I stood, I couldn't see anyone else doing it. Of course, now, you know, 10 years later, I've learned from experiences and from mistakes I made that, you know, when we're so in love with our ideas, we believe that we're the only ones who are thinking about it. No, but that's not true. The truth is that there are enough and more people out there who've thought about it. Some of them have succeeded and some of them have failed. And I would urge each one of you, you know, who's at some stage of nurturing an idea, to go out and find each one of those people. People who've succeeded, people who failed, to be able to learn from their experiences. And I think the ecosystem today is far more willing to share, far more enabling, far more ready to talk about, you know, successes and failures in a way that they didn't 20 years ago. I mean, 10 years ago, when I first set up my travel company, I had nobody telling me what to do and what not to do or what I could learn from their mistakes. So look, I mean, you know, now's a great time to be able to have those conversations because enough and more people out there willing to talk. Similarly with Mustard, which is a restaurant venture. We didn't go out to look to set up a restaurant. There was a space that landed itself in our laps and it was an opportunity. I mean, we could say yes or we could say no. I mean, the choice is always ours to make. But it was evident to us that, you know, if the space was going to be, was in Goa. This is way back in 2014. We don't want to be yet another eatery, yet another restaurant in Goa because Goa already had like 2,000 eateries. If we had to do food, it had to be food in a way that no one else ever did. So there again, the whole approach was that let's stand for something unique. Let's stand for something that will make people sit up and take notice of us because no amount of money that you can plow behind an idea which has been around for 10, 20 years. The truth is that somebody will come and, you know, spend more money on advertising or, you know, give better deals. And, you know, have you for breakfast before you've even woken up. So the point is that unless you're really, really distinctive, unless you're really, really unique, I would say, you know, just think and rethink because to be able to build a brand, I mean, I feel very good now when I look back. In these last 10 years, both Jaipur and Mustard have become brands which became much bigger than actually the size of the business. And I think, a large part of that brand building experience comes from knowing that we stood for something that no one else was really addressing. So, yeah.
Thank you, Shilpa, for that, because it is very easy. And I'm hearing dichotomies all the time because on one hand, we say for every idea that we have, and I'm talking to the audience, really, every idea that I have 100 other people who have the same idea, probably. Yeah, that's one reality. And the other reality that Shilpa just put the spotlight on is that unless you have an unconventional, really standing out sort of an idea, how are you going? So you have to be differentiated. Now, this is a clean dichotomy. You know, you are in a place where it's already so packed and crowded. How do you differentiate? And I want to take up Samira's question here. And maybe good, Shilpa, that you brought us to this point of branding. You know, is it so much brand, so much about me and an extension of me? Or does the marketplace really decide the brand? So Samira's question is so beautiful here. Can you help? And I would urge Ankita or Sanjay to take it up or anybody else on the panel, Anubha, Padma, Shilpa to take it up, but I would urge Ankita to start first on this question. Some pointers on how to create a platform in India while I am in Philippines. And then I clarified the question so that you could answer it a little better. Platform for my brand, as people don't know me in India, alliances from with marketing organizations seems very risky as they are not putting their skin in it. More so, it's tough to understand how your brand is handled. Yeah. So she wants to start a brand in India, sitting in Philippines. Do you have anything to say to her? And then I'd like to move the mic to Sanjay. Yeah. Ankita, over to you.
Right. Okay. So when I look at it, it doesn't really matter. I mean, of course, it's very important for you to physically be around when you're starting something from scratch, right? But for me, like, I just graduated from college. I did not have a lot of experience. It was almost like stepping into an abroad space, you know, when I started going into the production fraternity of fashion. And I just have one thing to say to you, that, you know, trusting someone to handle things for you when you're just starting out is very, very difficult because, like Sunita ji said, it's sort of, as an entrepreneur, whatever you do, whatever you're really passionate about is something that is an extension of you. Even from like my label, every single thing that I do, every collection, every shoot, every business decision that I make, everything is something that I see that is an extension of me, that I want my audience to resonate with that. So in terms of operations and handling everything, while it's very important for you to physically be somewhere, you know, that you should know the resources of, it's not entirely impossible for you to do it from a foreign space. If you find the right people to work with, which is going to be very difficult. I mean, people say that, you know, I just started my label right out of college. But what they don't know is that I had been doing my research, my development, my execution, idea, everything for more than a year. You know, it was almost like 18 months into making that then I finally launched. But yeah, finding the right people is very important. And it will take you many people, you know, that you meet with, that you ideate with, that you talk to, but they might not be the right person to fit that category for you. So you really have to take out the time to get to know who you're handling the operations with, who you're trusting, who is also putting their faith in you. You know, it's a very mutual two-way road. And it's not entirely impossible because, like I said, for me also, it was a completely foreign space. But you just have to get to know everything really well. You have to have like full research done about the market you're stepping into, the category you're going to fall into, and where you're going to take it from there. Even like what Shilpa ji said, you know, if you have to find that point of distinction, you're stepping into such a crowded space, you are supposed to know what makes you different, why somebody who's seeing like 1,000 fashion brands online would prefer coming to you, you know. So you have to have the point of distinction. You have to believe in your product. You have to portray your product into the market in a way that the audience resonates with it. So I think that's extremely important. And I would actually like to add one more little thing, is that when we were talking about steps of starting, you know, about how to start a brand or how to launch something, there are like, I never had like a blueprint plan of what I'm supposed to do and how I'm supposed to, you know, position myself time and after again. It's something that you learn as you go. You know, your market responds, your audience responds to what you're doing. You kind of understand what they are thinking, what they're expecting out of you, and you mold yourself and you mold your product in a way that it still carries out your creative language entirely, but they to the market out.
Yeah, you dropped a little bit, Ankita, but that was brilliant because I love the passion with which you said, you learn on the go, you adapt, the market adjusts with you, yeah. You adjust with the market. Yes, Sanjay, a few words on that.
Well, Philippines and India are no longer countries. They are just two points on an online highway. So I won't call geographies any challenge anymore. You just have two different compliance regimes. And as long as you do your business of business well, of understanding two compliance regimes, you are okay. I would ask the question in a reverse way. If somebody is sitting in Philippines and wants to operate in India market and wants to know how, first he or she could ask herself, what is that I can do for India and Philippines? Because that's a great way to start a relationship. If you can offer someone a brand or a company or an agency, a foothold in the country you are operating, you get started a relationship on a much sounder footing. And in exchange, you are then dealing with an Indian entity in practically helping. And this is the norm all over the world. The second thing is, I would go back to the carve and connect part of it, which was so well put by my colleague, that the connect part is important. And the connect can happen in many ways. I don't know whether it's a proprietary technology she wants to offer, what kind of a brand we are talking about. It's a food brand, it's a cloth brand. Because again, in the business of business, there is a brand management structure and a regime which you need to develop, and any ISO consultant would help you develop that, an SOP. There are ready-made SOPs available that if you are giving your brand for someone to market or to service or what all you need to do about it. And there are ready-made do-it-yourself ISO packages available about it. So again, I would go back to the business of business, that spend time and effort in understanding that whatever business you are doing, what is the business of business around it? How do you take it to another geographies? How do you manage your brand? How do you work out that it's a win-win situation, etc.? And of course, do not treat countries and regions anymore as distant places. They are all on online highway. Make sure that you are aware of the compliance regimes as they change every few kilometers on an highway.
Namaskar. Thank you.
Thank you, Samira, for that question. And you also asked about research, what research you should do. We have such academicians and research on the panel. It's not a surprise, me being from education, Sanjay being from education, Anubha from L&D. She actually did her PhD on leadership and followership. And the question, so Samira, you could reach out to anybody, including Padma, who's written books and publications, Shilpa, who is very academically inclined, Ankita, who's fresh out of college. Yeah. So talk about research to them. The question that comes to my mind, Anubha, is that you did your PhD on leadership and followership. Really, entrepreneurship, where does it sit in this continuum of leadership and followership? And if you could just give not an academic answer, but a little more tuned in answer to the audience about hum leader to hain apne apne field mein, par entrepreneur nahi ban pa rahe hain, because entrepreneur is far more dynamic, I think, than leadership. I'm making a value judgment here, but please go ahead.
Sure. So, the word followership is an answer in itself. I would say anyone who wants to become an entrepreneur, follow someone. Very simple. Do not go for making abracadabra in your life. Just follow someone. And trust me, there is something or the other, you will have admiration for someone, right? And whatever that person is doing, or whatever that organization is doing, or whatever that institution is doing, follow that, imbibe that, and then get a new set of creativity in that particular thing. And trust me, it is you are on a different leap altogether. So that is the very simple way. And you yourself in this journey will realize you will become a leader. So who stops you to become not to be a follower? I don't know why people say, I don't want to be a follower. And end of the day, we all are followers. You know, we are following our parents, the beautiful thing. We are following our, you know, but I, if you ask me, I follow every individual, whatever thing I like. So if I'm liking something in today's session about someone, I'm going to imbibe it. That's about it. And implement it.
You remind me of Jack Welch in GE. He was one of the most favorite leaders and most hated also for, and called Neutron Jack. He said, copy shamelessly. And what you said very beautifully was, you know, just emulating and behavior modeling around people who are leaders, who are entrepreneurs in your field, you could as it is, put yourself many notches ahead of people. But it requires a certain humility to follow. So Anubha, what you said very beautifully was a quality. So do leaders, and I think I'll come to Padma. Do, you know, in your field, there's so many fakes. By the way, you know, the brand Organic that you have started, and I was talking about the sugar brand to you the other day, Unrefined. I went back. It's exactly written in the way your label is written, but it's written on top in Chota, just Organic. J-U-S-T, and the same font. So, and when you told me categorically, no, you don't have sugar, I realized that branding and being in the marketplace, you find many people copying you or following you and saying, you know, I'm very inspired by so-and-so brand Organic, and therefore humne just Organic bana diya. How do you explain and justify such things in the marketplace, especially to a budding entrepreneur? Because I think some people after this call might become and start some of their passionate entrepreneurial journeys. So Padma, over to you.
Frankly, I think Sunita, the right person to answer this really is probably Shilpa. What I've created is really not really a brand as of now. It is just something which embodies the quality of the product. And what I understood was that if you make it about yourself, it's going to be very difficult to scale up at some time. So the brand essentially conveys a certain quality, right? A certain confidence that a consumer would have in that product. I mean, they would assume that that is there. So really, I'm not really the right person to do that when it comes to branding. I think branding, I should hand over to Shilpa to talk more about. And she has brands which are like recognized, you know, all over. So over to you, Shilpa, on this.
Before we give Shilpa the mic, before Shilpa takes it on, Padma, just to you know, ponder over that question a little bit more. You know, you did not answer the question about, is brand really an extension of yourself? Because you answered it very beautifully by saying, no, it should be about quality. So should it be, should it not? And that's something which you could answer before we ask invite Shilpa. Okay.
So very simply, no, it cannot be about you. You will bring something to the brand, but the brand cannot be about you because it is something which needs to survive you, right? So, I mean, in the government, we always understood this very beautifully because nothing belonged to you, right? It has to exist before you, it has to exist after you, and there has to be a continuum there. So no, the brand cannot be about you. You can bring something to the brand, but the brand is not you. I mean, this is something which I personally feel, I don't know how many would agree here, but no, it cannot be you. I mean, unless you're an actor or you're an Amitabh Bachchan and the brand is you, but otherwise, no.
Thank you for saying that. Ankita Jain, I would love to hear your comments after a while, after Shilpa speaks, because your brand is called Ankita Jain. So let's hear Shilpa before we come to Ankita. Yes, Shilpa.
So, my view on this is that as an entrepreneur, most of what we do is really an extension of the people we are. I'll say this from my own experience, and I totally hear what Padma says, what Padma has said. The brand has to outlive you. You know, it's not just something that's there in our lifetimes. The brand has to go beyond the person you are. But for me, each one of the businesses that, you know, I've had the opportunity to co-found or found, really are extensions of the person I am. You know, there is a certain radical approach. I mean, people tell me that, you know, as I've grown older, I've become more and more radical, and that I've taken that as a compliment. But that edginess that you see in Mustard, for example, or the edginess that we saw, you know, at Jaipur, in Jaipur, really was an extension of just the person I am. So for me, it becomes an extension of me. It's almost like an alter ego. What as responsible founders of businesses, you know, people who build brands, passionate founders of, you know, brands, we have to be mindful of the fact that whatever it is that we are building, whatever it is that we are creating, has to go beyond us. So that, you know, when we've moved on, the DNA of the brand you know, can sustain the brand and let it, you know, continue in perpetuity. So whether or not I continue to be associated with a Mustard or a Breakaway or Jaipur, which I'm no longer a part of, the truth is that the foundation that you lay in creating of that brand is what's going to be the most important factor in figuring, you know, how long and where the brand can go. And then, of course, there will be you know, different approaches. There will be a whole new perspective that will come in depending on somebody else's idea of scale, right? I mean, scale also is relative. It means different things to different people. Like, I believe that, you know, whilst there is an opportunity to scale Jaipur to a level where it can actually break boundaries. For example, when we started the brand, it was, you know, shipping online to about 80 countries worldwide. I mean, no amount of stores around the world was going to be able to capture that opportunity, right? To be able to ship to audiences around 80 countries worldwide. But over a period of time, you know, backed by, you know, brick and mortar stores, let's say in India, where online shopping is still far more nascent than it is in the West, it was evident to us that brick and mortar stores would become enablers to getting audiences to shop online. But, you know, I mean, my firm belief with Breakaway, which is a travel venture, is that experiences don't scale. You know, immersive experiences are all about a quality of interaction. So let me give you an example. I mean, craft and textile tourism, you know, we show up at a weaver's or a printer's workshop in the back of Beyond in let's say Ajrakpur or Dhamadka in Kutch or you know, Akola in Rajasthan. You show up once a month, he welcomes you with open arms, you know, he's willing to spend the time that you want to, looking at his work, talking about his work. But if you're at his doorstep every other day, he's gonna turn around and say, Ji, aap roz aa jaoge to, you know, hum apna kaam kab karenge. So and then there is that's when you start cutting corners, right? I mean, I do also feel that, you know, I don't have any VC investments to, you know, investors to manage anymore. So I can take the liberty of saying this, but quality and scale are not necessarily good friends, right? Something's going to have to give. And in wanting to scale up, then you have to start figuring out what it is that you will compromise on, what it is that you will cut corners on. It may not be quality. It may be something else. It may be, you know, and I've always believed, I'm a perfectionist. And whilst, you know, I don't believe that, you know, good is an enemy of great, the truth is that God is in the detail. And the uniqueness and the distinctiveness that I've talked about in terms of, you know, whatever it is that we must stand for, comes from having a very, very anal approach to quality and to design and to the delivery of that whole customer experience. So, you know, I mean, sorry, I'm going off on a rant, but you'll have to bring me back. Well, the truth is that, you know, brands don't get built overnight without passionate founders really bringing a part of themselves to whatever it is that they're saying. You know, the story behind the brand is always that of a passionate founder.
Yeah, I don't want to force fit that, Shilpa, into what Padma was saying, but I definitely want to make a point that both of you are talking about quality in a very beautiful way, and I love that. Anuba also brought that in. So it's really, if you have to get the brand up there and scale it, you might be cutting corners at beyond a certain point, and maybe that's the explanation of why you're no longer associated with Jaipur or currently Mustard being among the top 10, both ways. Yeah, Mustard being a top 10 restaurant in Bombay. Ankita, you wanted to, would you like to answer that in some way? Your brand is called Ankita Jain. And Sanjay, I'll also invite you to gather your thoughts around scale and quality. Then we'll start winding.
Right. Right. I completely agree with what Shilpa ma'am said, because at some point when you do entrepreneur and you're finding, you know, starting some adventure, it has to, in some way, like she said, it's an almost like an alter ego. It is somewhat an extension of who you are, what your beliefs are, what you want to provide to the customer. And another thing that she really pointed out, and I completely resonate with, is that experience cannot be scaled. You know how she talked about going to the artisans. If you were to do that every day, you would not be able to do his job and what he's known for. And for me, like when I'm, you know, working on, for example, like one of my collections is completely dedicated to hand-painted denims, which, you know, every time I go get an order, I sit at night with like a tripod and record the whole process and hand paint every single order on my own. You know, that's an experience that I'm providing to somebody who's investing in my brand, you know, even as a customer. When they're buying something which is not exactly affordable, but it has so much quality, it has so much story to it, that it cannot be scaled. You know, I have a vision. I mean, I'm too small to even think that far ahead in life, but I do have a vision. I want to, you know, employ as many artists, young artists, you know, who are in college, who are in school, who have such amazing, beautiful talent and skills. But because they're so young, that nobody, you know, they don't have any working opportunities per se. So as I grow, as I scale, I definitely want to get more artists on board, more artisans. I have recently started working with a lot of craftspeople from India. And employment generation is something that I really want to put focus on. Obviously, we don't know what happens ahead, but I really want to maintain an extension of myself in the brand, because I think that's what makes it different from other fashion brands. And more importantly, the brand will outlive who I am. But when I put a piece of myself out there, I find 10 other people who believe in the same thing, who resonate with it. And that's how we build a community. And I think that's how the brand will outlive me, you know, because there will just be a huge number of people who will resonate with the kind of work I'm doing. And that's all when you are willing to invest in your name.
Yeah, Ankita, I definitely want one of those jeans for sure. Yeah, I'm placing an order right here. We'll talk later.
Done.
Yeah, Sanjay, go ahead and comment on the scale and quality friendship that Shilpa talked about. Then we start winding down this call. We have two questions in the waiting.
Well, I will go with whatever has been said on the subject. Bilkul brand bachcho ki tarah hote hain. Aapka DNA hai usme. Aur apne ko outlive karne ki ichha se hi entrepreneurship shuru hoti hai. You want to create a legacy. That's why you are an entrepreneur. And you know ki aapke bachcho ki tarah wo bhi unko aapki zarurat ek din nahi hogi, and unki जो ब्यूटी होगी या उनकी जो आपकी लेगेसी यही होगी कि वो आपके बगैर और किसी के भी बगैर अपने आप अपने पैरों पे खड़े होंगे और सक्सेसफुल होंगे. सो आई एम वेरी मच ऑन द साइड दैट द ब्रांड हैज टू हैव योर डीएनए. एक्चुअली यू आर राइजिंग अप टू अ ब्रांड. यू वांट टू बी द एक्सेलेंट सेल्फ ऑफ यू. दैट इज व्हाई यू क्रिएटिंग समथिंग व्हिच इज हायर देन व्हाट यू आर टुडे. And with time, you would like it to rise it much beyond you, outlive you, as we always want things to outlive you and outclass you. That's how you are remembered onto that. So that's, having said that, मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि scaling वाला जो part है brand का, उसके पीछे भी जैसे शिल्पा ने कहा, foundation बहुत जरूरी है. आप 24 मंजिल की इमारत नहीं बना सकते अगर उसमें नींव 24 मंजिलों की नहीं पड़ी हुई या 30 मंजिलों की नहीं पड़ी हुई. सो व्हाटएवर ग्रेट ब्रांड्स वी सी टुडे, वी हैव टू कॉम्प्लीमेंट द ओरिजिनल फाउंडर्स दैट दे लेड सच अ सॉलिड फाउंडेशन फॉर इट इन टर्म्स ऑफ क्वालिटी प्रोसेसेस, पीपल, द प्रोसेसेस व्हिच अंडरस्टैंड्स मार्केट्स एंड कस्टमर्स कंटिन्यूअसली, the level of innovation they introduced. They created a self-fulfilling prophecy. They created a self-fulfilling mechanism which is fit for survival for the future. So I will go with Shilpa that the foundation you are putting in is very important, and then rest is a matter of time which happens. But you need to put the DNA in your brand, and we must make sure that DNA ultimately outclasses you.
Thank you, Sanjay. Vrinda is asking a question. I started my business a year back. My Garima, I'll be coming to your question soon. I started my business a year back. My business is in the service industry. Wanted to know, how do I get help to scale up? Yes, it may sound like a commonplace question, but it's a very different product. My company name is Rolling Wheels, and we do car detailing at doorstep in Mumbai. Does anybody on the panel have an idea that you can offer to Vrinda? or thought? Thank you for your question, Vrinda.
Vrinda, can you help us
understand
what card detailing is?
So I started this business a year back. Car detailing basically means car cleaning, polishing, coating. It has to do with the aesthetics of the car, keeping it clean and tidy, inside cleaning, outside cleaning, as well as giving it a polished look, basically the showroom look. You don't have to go to a showroom. We do it at doorstep. So I have come up with a van which is self-sufficient with all the machines, tools and all. And I have staff who is well-equipped professional. And so I have just started a year back, and this service I've started in Mumbai. So it's a new venture, getting very good response. But I want to scale up more. So currently I'm the only one doing marketing, branding, managing the staff, everything, because I have limited means. I've started this with my own self-funded money, which I was working with a corporate company for 12 years, and I've saved money, and I wanted to do something on my own. And my husband had that idea. He was from automobile background, and he guided me. And I thought that it's a brilliant idea. And I was just looking for something to venture out on my own. I had that passion to start something, and I just did. I just left my job and I started. Now I want to scale up, and I'm seeing that there's a response. I'm seeing that people do want doorstep service. People don't want to go out, and you know, they don't have time. So now the doorstep service is the next in thing in service industry. So I think there is potential, but I want some, I'm looking out for some support wherein, you know, I can get some guidance on how to scale up. And of course, how do I go ahead with funding? Because I think now that there's a time where I know how to scale up. I know how the means I can through which I can scale up. I'm much more into social media. I learned social media marketing, and I'm doing it on my own because every penny saved is a penny earned. So right now I'm running on less budget. So I want some help in how do I find some good funding or any other help to scale up. So I heard all of you, and I'm pretty happy to hear the story of everyone. Being a new entrepreneur.
Vrinda, if you need an answer to your question, you'll have to stop talking because we're also running out of time. What I'd like to say, there's one thought that I'd like to leave you with, which is that, you know, maybe you might want to consider reaching out to insurance companies who deal with, you know, car insurance policies to see if you can strike some kind of collaboration with them, because they have access to databases of car owners across different kinds of, you know, hatchbacks and sedans and, you know, luxury cars. Talk to them and, you know, negotiate a deal with them where they can offer car detailing services to all their policyholders in Bombay to begin with, because you're only in Bombay. But that might be a good starting point. And just one piece of advice for the future is, when you have a question, try and keep it as crisp as possible, because you end up otherwise compromising on the quantum of time somebody else has to answer your question. Okay, so just keep it very, very short. Yeah, but insurance companies might be a good place to start.
Yeah, lovely idea there, Shilpa. Thank you so much for that idea. I think that's what great entrepreneurs are made of, 100 ideas at one go. Padma, I'm going to invite you here. Being a corporate trainer, okay, there's Garima on the call, who's a corporate trainer, pranic healer, instructor and pranic healer, wants to get an insight on how can she further get an opportunity to connect with people to nurture and develop. So, you know, she wants to tap into the market. Is there some way you can suggest to her for positioning or just guiding how to build the social capital where she can get more clients? I think that's what Garima's question is.
Frankly, I think all of us have existing networks, and we first start with finding the right fit with the existing networks. And that would be, I guess, the first place to start when you're doing something of this sort. Frankly, that's the way I began, and that's how then you start reaching out to a lot more people.
Thank you, Padma. Sanjay, any tip for her, for Garima, and then Anubha?
Well, digital marketing is the future and the present. I think she would have more than her share of reach if she uses it with the right means and with the right intensity.
Yeah, have many clients at present. That's what she's saying. Have many clients at present, but want to further have more. And I think it grows organically when you have quality with you. Anubha, you want to comment on that?
So if you'll ask me personally, okay. So I'll take up first one is for Varunda. I have already given an insight. Okay. And the second one is for Garima. So Garima, if you really have a great client, my suggestion is then you can actually do a referral program. That is one. And create a bigger market for yourself. I think future is all wellness and about science of well-being. So I think if you can actually bouquet your product to a larger set of people, maybe to an organization or to an institution, it can be a big business and big model for you. So think on that line probably.
I'm not one of the panelists, but I'll quickly say this, Garima, for you, that each time you do a great work, it just exponentially becomes 10 other great assignments. Yeah, from every work you get at least 10 other assignments. Right, Ankita? I can see you nodding your head. Yeah, that's how it grows. It grows amoebically, especially in very customized work like pranic healing, etc. It's absolutely one-to-one work done in very intimate settings. So it has to be done. So focus on the quality of your work, Garima, and that's all. And leave the rest to God. Yeah, it just works.
Yeah, and also I would like to add when you say that you have great clientele, I think your clientele is your biggest marketing tool here, because they refer to one person, one family member, one friend, and it can just go like a huge way from there. So like Anubha ji said, you can have like a referral program. I think that works really well if you have like a set clientele that's already coming to you, believes in you. And just maintaining the quality of the service that you're providing is very important.
Yeah.
Okay, so one more insight I would like to give, as I talked about followership. Garima, I think look into Art of Living courses. I don't say that follow them, but understand their structure. It is beautifully done up. Or maybe Shivananda's, or so understand their model. Apply the best thing and then enhance and improvise accordingly. Trust me.
Sadhguru's brand is doing really well. Okay, before we steer off and veer off, and we have just 2-3 minutes, I'd like one takeaway sentence from each of our panelists here. What would you like the audience to take away from you? Please make it crisp, but make it solid and make it so much yourself. Can we start with Padma? A takeaway.
So, when the time comes, don't be scared to jump. So I'll leave it there.
My favorite line is jump and you'll build your wings along the way.
Yeah. So true.
Yes, Ankita, go ahead.
I think one takeaway should be just believe in your passion, your creativity, and it'll take you places.
Yeah. And tie up passion with compassion. It works really well.
Yes, yes, yes.
While you're doing this noble work of entrepreneurship, you're going to create jobs. Ankita didn't say that, but one of her biggest passions is to create jobs and employment. And that's... Thank you. Sanjay, you'd like to go next? Can you mute mics? Manju, can we have everybody's mics? Yeah.
I have a very simple message for those who are thinking of it, that this is the time to decide about two possible losses. One is the loss of money and career time if you want to be an entrepreneur. Is that a great loss if you fail? Or is that a great loss of the failure of not having tried in this life?
Not having tried, yes. Yeah, what's a greater loss? You're gonna have to try.
Choose the loss and do accordingly.
Yes. Thank you, Garima, for that. Yes, Anubha's takeaway was really beautiful. Anubha, can you repeat that for us? The crazy creative part?
Yeah. Okay. So the first one is carve your goals. Second one is connect with the best of the people. Be crazy. And the fourth is be creative. So, you know, to put it in a nutshell, I think I'll make it very simple for everyone. My brand is Prism Philosophy. So it's nothing but an acronym. So P is prepare. Whatever you want to do in life, prepare first. R is respect. You need to respect yourself for whatever you're doing. I is implement. Whatever you have prepared, you need to implement, because execution is key to success. S is share. Either you fail or you succeed, please share it, because the sharing really makes you, you know, empower to the next level. And finally, maintain. That is M. Whatever you've been doing good, keep maintaining it. Follow Prism Philosophy with that note. That's my small takeaway.
Anubha, I'm going to add a fifth C with your permission, and that is to complete, and to complete on time. And to complete everything which you have started is also a very entrepreneurial trip. And I'm personally experiencing it, that, you know, some of us women entrepreneurs especially will understand this. It's in a cycle. You start something, complete it, and then you grow to the next level.
Yes.
And the next level. So there is a one iteration, one orbit, which you have to complete before you move to the next. Shilpa, your words before we close the session.
Never miss out on an opportunity to learn from the next person, because there's always something that will come out of that opportunity. And, you know, just be wide awake, keep your ears peeled to the ground, because opportunities will just pass you by if you're not awake.
Yeah, and what wonderful last message, because this is a learning platform. Thank you, Manju, for putting on those slides. You guys, everybody in the audience, please do follow the five people who took effort and time to be here to do this session for you. And I hope you have taken away what you intended to take away. If not, do reach out to them and to me also. And thank you, BGCL, for hosting this. And thank you, BGCL, for doing this wonderful work, because I want to close with one line. If more and more women could just break the shackles and believe that entrepreneurship is possible for them, you know, it's not just Anubha can do it and Ankita can do it and, you know, oh, only Shilpa can be Shilpa. And, you know, only Padma can be Padma taking a voluntary retirement. And or Sanjay can be Sanjay. No, each one of us in this group, I do want to urge you to believe in yourself and take it on, because entrepreneurship really is an answer to India's bigger dreams. So thank you so much for being here. And we're signing off now. Thank you. Thank you, Manju, for this.
Thank you.